Welcome students and viewers. So in this lecture I am going to explain you mechanism of symbiotic nitrogen fixation. So till previous lecture we have seen the nodule formation and development, and now in this lecture we will see actual mechanism of a symbiotic nitrogen fixation. So see, mechanism of nitrogen fixation in root nodules. Now root nodules has developed. Now it's a duty of rhizobium bacteria to fix the nitrogen. So now see, again here one more important point. Let me take pen. Leg hemoglobin, right? So leg hemoglobin is nothing but what? It is a one kind of pigment which is present in a plants, right? One kind of pigment which is red or pink in color, and it is present in a leguminous plant, and that pigment is called as leg. So leg stands for the leguminous plants. As it is found in a leguminous plants, it is called as leg, right? And this hemoglobin, it is a pigment which is present within the leguminous plants. So therefore this pigment is named as leg hemoglobin, right? And see here, this leg hemoglobin in short form, it is written as this. L stands for leguminous and HB. Okay, it's HB, similar like present in a body, right? So HB, L, HB, capital L, capital H and small b. Right, so see the first characteristic we will see this. So LHB has the characteristics similar to the myoglobin or variety of hemoglobin found in the animal. So what's the role played by hemoglobin in our body? Is it is the oxygen carrier, right? Hemoglobin is the oxygen carrier, and suppose the hemoglobin will be less, we are suffering some suffocation. Okay, breathlessness will be there in our body. So in case of plant also, hemoglobin, this hemoglobin plays a very important role. It catches the oxygen present within it. So see, it is red in color due to presence of iron, right? So due to presence of this iron, this pigment, it is red in color, or it is somewhat pinkish in color, right? So having the nodule, see, this is the root and these are the root hairs or the nodules which are present. So having this reddish or pinkish color nodule, come to know that it has the leg hemoglobin in it, right? So by observing the color of the nodule, we are going to confirm that leg hemoglobin is present. Okay. For the first time, LHB was isolated and crystallized from the soybean root nodule. So for the first time, from whom? From soybean root nodule, this leg hemoglobin was isolated and crystallized. Then LHB is found only in healthy nodules. See, this is a very important characteristic. It is found only in healthy nodules. It is not at all found in non-healthy nodules, right? So this is very important point to remember. It is going to form, it is going to found only in healthy nodules. So LHB is present outside the bacterial membrane. Where exactly? Peribacteroid space, but in their close contact, right? So LHB is given by whom? It is given by plant, right? So it is present nearby. Suppose, let me take, suppose this is the cell, right? And this is small our bacteria. So this hemoglobin is come in contact with this bacteria, right? LHB. So this will be present like this. Getting? So where it is? In a particular peribacteroid space. The space which is present nearby or the periphery of the bacterial membrane is called as peribacteroid space. Now, next, indirectly, LHB promotes the O2 utilization in bacteroids and favors nitrogen fixation, right? So as I discussed, as I explained you earlier in my videos, what the condition is required for this well functioning of nitrogenase. So nitrogenase will function only in absence of oxygen, right? So wherever the oxygen is present within the cell, that is taken up by these leg hemoglobin pigment. Please do remember, okay? So LHB is going to utilize this oxygen within the cells of the root of leguminous plants, right? And hence it creates the oxygen tensed environment, or it creates the oxygen free environment so that nitrogenase enzymes function well, or it carried out the fixation of nitrogen, right? So see here next, the condition where the host plants suffer from O2 deficiency, LHB serves to facilitate the movement of O2 to O2 poor tissues, right? Means from a particular cell, now here bacteria resides. Now bacteria wants to fix the atmospheric nitrogen, right? Now the LHB, which is present over here, it takes the oxygen from this cell and then it will transfer to the another tissues or another cell where O2 is poor, O2 is not present, right? And hence the other tissues get respires, and the benefit for O2 which is getting transferred from here, who is going to benefit? Nitrogen is going to benefit, because nitrogen is has now the free environment, a comfortable suitable environment to fix the atmospheric nitrogen. Now see the next, oxygen level, let me change the color of my pen. Oxygen level above 0.5 atmosphere inhibit the nitrogen fixation due to inactivation of nitrogenase. See, this is very important. So O2 concentration should not be more than 0.1 atmospheric oxygen, right? Suppose it is going to reach again till 0.2 atmospheric oxygen, then only this nitrogenase activity is going to inhibit, right? So our oxygen concentration should be a minimum. If the oxygen concentration, if it is going to reach up to 0.5, see 0.5 again, it's very higher amount, very higher level of oxygen, right? So in this 0.5, this activity of nitrogenase will not be happen. Okay, till here it's going to work. If it is reached to 0.2 atmospheric oxygen, then again it's going to inhibit the oxygen nitrogenase activity. And if the oxygen level is reached above the 0.5 atmospheric oxygen, then obviously the nitrogenase enzyme, it's suppressed. It will not work, right? So please do remember this concentration. So LHB combines with oxygen to form oxyhemoglobin, right? So we have to remove this higher concentration of oxygen. So who is coming forward? So who is coming? Leg hemoglobin pigment is coming forward to combine this oxygen, or to remove this oxygen from a particular cell, right? And it's going to form oxyhemoglobin, right? O2, when going to combine with the leg hemoglobin, it is going to form oxyhemoglobin, right? And this again, formation of oxyhemoglobin is again depend on the heme protein which is present in leg hemoglobin, right? Heme protein which is highly labile to oxygen.
means if this heme protein is present, again obviously leg hemoglobin is directly come in contact with this oxygen, it will combine and then it will form the oxyhemoglobin, right? So we are writing capital L, capital H, small b for leg hemoglobin. If it combine with the oxygen, then it will form capital O, capital L, capital H and small b, OLHB, right? When it going to form. So why it is a need to fix this, combine this oxygen, right? So because we want the oxygen free environment for nitrogenase activity. Just recall the previous my lecture where I have mentioned in case of cyanobacteria, I have mentioned that the oxygen is combined with whom? With NADPH. It is one of the cofactor NADPH, which is produced during oxidative pentose phosphate pathway, right? Just recall it. And that NADPH is going to combine with the oxygen and hence the ferredoxin is getting reduced, right? And then ferredoxin sending electron towards the nitrogenase enzyme, and then nitrogenase enzyme perform or to fix this atmospheric nitrogen. Now here in case of plants also, this oxygen is taken up by whom? Oxygen is taken up by leg hemoglobin pigment. In case of algae, oxygen is taken up by NADPH. Please do remember or go back to my previous lecture, right? So this leg hemoglobin combine with the oxygen to form oxyhemoglobin, and that will create the O2 tensed environment so that nitrogenase will function properly. Now oxyhemoglobin maintains very low concentration. See, again the same over here, of free oxygen, and does create oxygen tense environment, right? And that can this condition allows the nitrogenase to function properly, right? At the same moment, oxygen is delivered to cytochrome oxidase. Now OLHB, where it goes? OLHB, it goes to these cytochrome oxidase, right? It will goes to the cytochrome oxidase, and the nodule respires aerobically, and hence the oxygen is used as terminal electron acceptor, right? So cytochrome oxidase, it comes in a terminal electron acceptor. Okay, this is the last cycle where this oxygen is used. Now how does nitrogenase work, right? Now till here what we have seen, only we have created the environment, right? We have created the environment so that nitrogenase now work properly. Nitrogenase will fix the atmospheric nitrogen. We have removed the oxygen with the help of hemoglobin, leg hemoglobin, right? Now the proper activity of nitrogenase enzyme. Now see here, I have given this one image. So see here what oxygen is present. That oxygen is taken up by whom? LHB, right? Leg hemoglobin, and that is going to convert into oxy LHB or OLHB, right? Now that OLHB going to cytochrome oxidase, and then cell will respire, nodule will respire. Now here see one more point. These are the carbohydrates which are available by the plant, right? And this is synthesized during photosynthesis, and that carbohydrate utilized by the bacteria for its respiration, and that is going to convert into CO2 and H2O. And during this respiration, electron is given out, or the energy is given out. That energy, it is in the form of ATP, right? So MgATP, in my previous lecture also I have explained you Mg++, that magnesium ions, they are the activator, they are activates the actual reaction, right? And ATP is the energy required for
the nitrogenase enzyme. So Mg ATP is coming from whom? Mg ATP is coming from bacterial respiration. So how bacterial respire? Carbohydrate, which is made available by the plant, and then it respires, and hence the during respiration we know that not only this, during respiration energy is created, right? So in ATP, how it going to form? When Mg ADP, adenosine diphosphate, combines with the inorganic phosphate, then it's going to form Mg ATP, and that will gives the electron to this nitrogenase enzyme, right? So this electron is accepted by this thing, okay? Electron is taken up by whom? Taken up by oxidized ferredoxine, right? So again, see, same reaction is shown over here. Carbohydrate, they are going to convert into CO2 and H2O, and this energy is given out. It is one electron is given out, and that electron is taken up by oxidized ferredoxine. And oxidized ferredoxine, when it takes the electron, this electron, it going to convert into a reduced ferredoxine, right? And this reduced ferredoxine, again it gives its electron to whom? To oxidized Fe protein. Okay, we know that this Fe protein is the smaller subunit of nitrogenase enzyme, and MoFe protein is the largest subunit of nitrogenase enzyme, right? And the same, as I explained earlier, same way this Fe protein, which is oxidized form, that is taken up this electron and get converted into a reduced form. It's reduced form, right? And again, this electron is getting transferred to oxidized form of molybdopharoprotein, and then it converted into a reduced MoFe protein, and simultaneously it's going to convert into a Fe protein, oxidized Fe protein. And hence, once this reduced MoFe protein, it's in reduced form. Please do remember, student, when this MoFe protein is reduced form, now this is the particular stage of that nitrogenase enzyme to fix or to combine with this atmospheric nitrogen. So MoFe protein should be in reduced form here, and at this stage of nitrogenase will combine with whom? Will combine with nitrogen, and then it will going to form this 2NH3. So as I have explained in a previous lecture, NH3 is nothing but what? Ammonia. Ammonia is very harmful to the plants. It will burn the leaves, it will again blacken the roots, and ultimately plant will die. Okay, if ammonia remain as it is within the cells. So immediately this ammonia should be converted into rest of the amino acids, right? So this ammonia, it combines with GS. GS, first G is here, GS and GOGAD. This plays very important role in converting this ammonia into a rest of the amino acids, right? So I have explained you this first, this GS should be in higher condition, means in high amount, and GOGAT should be less, means both the enzymes, they are present over here. So when this GS is nothing but what? Glutamine synthetase. Please remember, GS nothing but glutamine synthetase enzyme. When it's present in a higher amount, then this glutamate or glutamic acid along with this ammonia going to convert into glutamine. Okay, glutamate right now. So now question arises, when this glutamate again comes, hai na? So this glutamine again combines with this GOGAT. See here, this glutamine going to combine with the GOGAT. GOGAT means what? Glutamine oxoglutarate aminotransferase. You think these are the enzyme names, synthetase, S, C here,
and AT, amino transferase. First G of GOGAT and first G of this GS is for glutamine only, right? So here glutamine, which is synthesized by this amino and glutamic acid, combines with GOGAT, okay, GOGAT enzyme. So GOGAT, glutamine, oxoglutarate, amino transferase, glutamine plus these two oxoglutarate going to convert into, let me change the color, these two molecules, molecule number one, molecule number two, okay, two molecules of glutamic acid, okay, this is also a glutamic acid. I will write only mic acid, okay, ATE. Yesterday also, in previous lecture also, I have explained this acid, glutamic or glutamate, right? So this glutamine along with two oxoglutarate and with the help of enzyme GOGAT will convert into two molecules of glutamic acid or glutamate. One molecule is going to convert into these amino acids. Amino acid aggregated together to form proteins, and proteins they are there in the plants, right? And the another second molecule, it is combines with whom? Again, this ammonia, and with the help of again glutamine synthetase, this glutamine is going to form. Okay, so this is again the chain which is going to happens once this ammonia is going to form, right? So this ammonia should be removed. So ammonia removed in where? In a first, this is the first amino acid, and this is the second glutamic acid. This is the second amino acid. So likewise, this amino acid, they are synthesized from ammonia, like, and then this amino acid, they are useful for the plant for various activities. So likewise, this nitrogen is nitrogenase enzyme, it works to fix this atmospheric nitrogen, okay, and this is the reaction where one molecule of ATP, see, to fix the one molecule of ATP, 16 ATPs are required, okay, how many? 16 ATP along with 8 electrons and 10 hydrogen atoms, right, and then it going to form two this ammonium ions. See, again you may be confused with NH3 and NH4+, right? So NH3 stands for ammonia, whereas NH4+, it stands for ammonium ion. Okay, NH4 is nothing but what? Ammonium ion. So I have explained you this. Ammonium ion is a non-toxic form of ammonia which is synthesized, right? So ammonium ion, if it is synthesized, it is non-toxic, and it can be, if it is remain as it is within the plant, there is no harm to the plant, right? But if the ammonia is remain as it is harmful to the plant, and hence it has to be immediately converted into a amino acid, as I have explained you, this glutamine and glutamic acids, right? So for this reaction, see here, so 16 ATPs, they are going to convert it into a 16 ADP plus 16 inorganic phosphates. 16 PI, P for phosphate, I for inorganic, right? So likewise, these for conversion of one molecule of nitrogen, these 16 ATPs, they are utilized. So likewise, the nitrogen fixation takes place in a root nodules of leguminous plants. And this enzyme, please do remember GS and GOGAT. They are helpful for the synthesis of this glutamine amino acids and glutamic amino acid. Now, next part is energy and oxygen relation in symbiotic association. So see, energy is required for the reaction of entofixation, and host plant supplies the energy. Yes, just right now we have seen the ATP, right? So ATP is given by the plant only, right? Energy is given by the plant only for the well functioning of nitrogenase enzyme. So rhizobia used photoassimilated carbon via the Krebs cycle. See, it used the photoassimilated carbon and generates the ATP energy. So therefore, rhizobia are carbon drain on their host. See, so we know that rhizobia, they are symbiotically associated with the plants. So rhizobia takes the carbon and then they are generating ATP during their respiration, right? And in turns, the plant get fixed nitrogen. So vice versa, they are helping each other. Rhizobia takes the carbon, they generates the energy and it fixes the nitrogen, and plant gets the nitrogen from rhizobia bacteria. So it has been estimated theoretically that 10 to 20 kg loss in plant dry matter for every kg nitrogen fixed. Means for 1 kg of nitrogen, if we want to fix, then this 10 to 20 kgs of loss should be there to the plant, right? Then therefore, end to fixation, there is a significant burden on the plant for extra cost of energy, right? Means plant want the nitrogen, but they has what? Extra burden on them, right? So that should be provide carbon. So once it will provide the carbon, it will create the energy. Once it get the energy, then rhizobia is able to fix the atmospheric nitrogen, right? So hence the plant has the extra burden on them to provide the carbon to the rhizobia, right? So moreover, about 50% of the carbon is stored in the nodule and about 40% of the carbon is respired in the soil by nodules, and the remaining 10% of the carbon is translocated above the ground part of legume plants. Okay, so likewise, the 50% of carbon only stored in the nodule. So how much percentage of carbon is utilized, depending on that the nitrogen is getting fixed. So likewise, this is the energy and oxygen relation in symbiotic association. So likewise, I have completed with the nitrogen fixation in root nodule of leguminous plants. Thank you for patience listening.